And now, our feature presentation.
Fire him past the crowd at the Yonkers Raceway in Yonkers, New York. During his 15-year career, Hugo has been blasted into the air thousands of times, earning him a string of colorful nicknames such as the Human Cannonball, the Living Projectile, and the Mortal Missile. You can't be a man of Hugo's caliber without the proper safety equipment. A protective mask, hat, goggles, gloves, as well as a thick leather jumpsuit are all part of the great Zucchini's regular working attire. With all his protective gear in place, he is now nearly ready to enter the cannon's barrel. The barrel is elevated to a 45-degree angle for what will be a 175-foot shot. In just a few moments now, Hugo Zucchini will become a 90-mile-an-hour human cannonball.
Hugo! Are you ready?
There he goes. And it's a perfect landing on the net. Now in slow motion. Hugo accelerates to 90 miles an hour, rises as high as a six-story building, and then flies into the net 175 feet away. For Hugo Zucchini, one good blast deserves another.
Preview of the hour ahead.
Jim Chambers is an accomplished hot air balloonist with the amazing ability to land his balloon nearly anywhere, even atop another balloon.
I'm Fran Tarkenton. Competing in a marathon race requires courage and endurance. It takes even more of both when Bud Harris competes in one of these 26-mile contests.
I'm Cathy Lee Crosby.
We'll meet Rawson Stovall, a pint-sized entrepreneur. At 10, he's a recognized expert on video games and a nationally syndicated columnist.
This unique desert castle took one man 18 years to build. It was the last act of a father fulfilling his daughter's dream. We'll tell you the heart-rending tale.
When an accident left young Donna Dupree trapped under a 2-ton crate, there was no time to call for help and no way for her two friends to move the crate by themselves. But they did.
A disease called dystonia leaves its victims unable to control their muscles and usually confined to wheelchairs. But a tiny electrical implant cured this woman's symptoms.
All this and more.
Tonight on...
That's Incredible! Story is about an artist who specializes in a field called living art.
His works aren't painted on canvas or chiseled out of stone.
They're created with the help of Mother Nature, and they sometimes need weeding and mowing.
Bill Harding's favorite medium is grass, but his growing method is unconventional, to say the least.
This 1966 Buick is one of his latest creations. It's part of an artistic concept that began several years ago in art school.
I was doing a performance at the Art Institute, the Kansas City Art Institute, and this man comes out on stage and he's dressed in a business suit and he has this briefcase and he opens it up and shows it to the audience and it's filled with this lush green grass. And he puts the briefcase down, takes off his shoes and socks, and steps into it and just walks around in it, and it's like his little portable park, his little bit of nature that he carries around with him. From doing that, I got the idea to grow grass on a business suit. I grow it on a polyester suit that you'd find in a thrift store. The mesh of the material is such that The roots on the grass grow right into the fabric, and when you're wearing the suit, they're touching your skin.
Bill expanded his grass growing technique to include cars.
I spray the car with the petroleum-based industrial adhesive. Then I spread the seeds on there, and I sing to the car pretty much every day while it's growing, especially after it sprouts. Like in L.A., I wrote a really good song out there, and I sung it to the car a lot.
Bill's technique is very straightforward. He liberally applies Manhattan ryegrass seed to every square inch of the car, except the windows, of course.
Then he carefully saturates his newly sown lawn with water.
To create the right growing environment, Bill turned his garage into a greenhouse.
I build a system of frames that hang over the car on ropes. This holds plastic over the top of the car, and there's like, it's always wet around the car, so there's a water seal. This holds all the moisture in, and when I walk out, when I go out in the garage in the morning, there would be a tiny drop of dew. A little drop of water on every single blade, and you'd open this up and just this forest, this just beautiful forest, like almost like a city. When I grow the car, I develop this kind of maternal instinct for it. I'm really always very surprised or just elated when it sprouts. In California, the car sprouted in just 48 hours. I was really surprised. I grew the car out there in just 11 days. It had a mat of grass on it about 4 inches, pretty thick too.
Bill doesn't spend all of his time watching his car's grass grow. He's got shoes and hats to tend to, not to mention his wardrobe of fresh green jackets.
And now the finishing touch before the car goes on its maiden voyage, custom-grown hubcaps.
Hubcaps in place, this mobile lawn on four wheels takes to the highway, his blacktop gallery for his work of living art.
It's not really a functioning environment, it's more a metaphor for an environment.
There are numerous advantages to a grass-covered car. Trips to the car wash are eliminated. You don't have to worry about dents in the body. And if you are an artist in search of a following, this is a surefire way of attracting one.
Reactions from bystanders vary. They just aren't sure what to make of it.
I think it's really beautiful, and I couldn't believe it was real, so I had to come over and touch it.
My first reaction is why?
Just to make people happy, give them some kind of distraction, just to kind of make them think about cars and nature and the city.
I've never seen anything like that to equal it.
It's Manhattan ryegrass.
That's refreshing.
Bill has stretched the meaning of art to include a little entertainment for the working man and woman trapped in the concrete jungle. No one can really explain the sometimes extraordinary effects of sheer human willpower. It's impossible, we'd assume, for a middle-aged person, for example, to lift a car. But if a loved one were trapped under that car, the impossible could happen. In fact, it has happened.
Some folks were working in a barn one day, and they were just ordinary folks going about doing their chores, never dreaming that the incredible was about to occur.
It happened at Lloyd's Crisco's tobacco farm in West End, North Carolina. And the story began with a woman named Donna Dupree.
Well, I work on Lloyd Crisco Senior's farm. The tobacco comes in from the field on a trailer, and then we hook the horse to it and lift it up so they can move the trailer out of the way. And then we put the box on the ground and put metal pins in it. After we get through pinning it, we lift it up and get ready to put it in the barn. Last year there was a bad accident down here.
We were putting the 4,000-pound bin of tobacco in the barn to dry. And at the time, we had it about 3 feet off the ground, and we got it halfway where two wheels were sitting on the rack, and the other two were in midair, and the chain snapped.
The box fell, and it pinned me to the ground. I just knew I was going to die. I knew I couldn't. There wasn't no way they could pick it up off him. And I told him, I said, Lord, I said, for God's sake, I said, you got to get it off of me. I said, it's killing me.
I tried to pick the box from a standing point. We could not. I said, God help. We dropped to our knees, lifted the box. My grandson David Joyce pulled her from underneath the box.
Everybody was running around and hollering and screaming, and I heard them say, go call the rescue squad, and Lloyd, he pulled me over to the side, and he was holding my head. He told me, he said, it's going to be all right. About that time, the rescue squad came, and they took me to the hospital.
Dr. Cecil Neville picks up the story.
We originally thought that she would have severe injuries. The injuries turned out to be relatively minor. To our knowledge, she has totally and 100% recovered.
Investigators came to have a look at the barn box. From the looks of it, it didn't seem as if a dozen men could move it, let alone two.
They placed special scales under it to determine just how much the box actually weighed. Remember that the world's record for deadlifting achieved by a trained athlete in his prime is 886 pounds.
This weighs 2 tons, 150 pounds.
When I was in my prime, the most I have ever known myself to pick up was, and show it was 200 pounds.
Every year, thousands of people compete in marathon races. A marathon is so grueling that many never make it as far as the finish line. In Colorado, though, there's a marathoner who displays a special fortitude. Since a tragic accident years ago, life has been one long marathon race for Bud Harris.
I'm 49 years old, and I'm a long-distance racer. I run 5Ks to marathons. I've been an athlete all my life. I played semi-professional baseball, played high school football. I was in an automobile accident when I was 30 years old. Car got airborne. I flew out and it landed on top of me. So it left me a paraplegic. I'm paralyzed from the waist down. After the accident, I was confined to a wheelchair. And over a period of years, I had a lot of traumatic pain. I had several surgeries for pressure areas. And I eventually became confined to a gurney. When I started using the gurney, I tried to figure out a way that I could use it to my benefit, something that would keep me active in any type of activity if I could get in sports. And after a while watching people in wheelchairs, I decided that maybe I could learn to run as fast as they do on the gurney. I exercise each day on the hospital grounds for maybe an hour and a half, 2 hours, until I use the gurney as best I could learn to use it. And I realized then that I could never be competitive in any sport or anything with this. So I realized that I had to modify, I had to change it some way. So I lowered the hospital gurney, I narrowed it, and I shortened it. I took the table off, which weighed approximately 40 pounds. It was an inch plywood and 3 inches of foam, and put an aluminum top on. I went from a standard hospital gurney, which weighed approximately 100 pounds, to what you see now weighs 20 pounds. It's lighter, smoother, and much more maneuverable.
Bud's unique stretcher allows him to do what he loves best, race in marathons. Bud calls it running.
I'm very dedicated to this racing. It's one thing I can do, and it's something I like to do. So I put a lot of time and effort into this.
At the Rawhide Marathon in Fort Collins, Colorado, Bud was one of the 14 wheelchair runners. He's the only one who competes belly down on a stretcher.
They're off. A long, strenuous 26-mile course lies ahead. Bud cut 45 minutes from his average running time just by switching from wooden walking canes to rubber-tipped ski poles to propel his stretcher. He's in top form today.
Most weeks I run from 100 to 150 miles. I train 5 days a week, and I race on the weekends, so I run 7 days a week. The course is almost built for wheelchair racing. It's a 700-foot drop in 26 miles. It's possibly three obstacles or hills on the course. The rest of it is from flat to downhill. The hills are very challenging to me. That's where the real work and excitement is. Now I like to compete against the hill. Before the hill beat me up, now I beat the hill up.
Bud has always been determined not to let anything beat him. He overcame the accident that left him paralyzed. Then, only months before this race, Bud's legs were amputated because of a life-threatening infection. He met that crisis with the same inner strength he draws on to get to the top.
Relief, but still has another 18 and a half miles to go.
I get the satisfaction in running a marathon by doing the best I can do on the course. I try to beat the course. I would like to be first overall, but the thing I want to do is the best job that I can when I run any race. So I work hard at it.
After a grueling 26 miles, the first wheelchair competitors come in. Here comes Bud. Bud crosses the finish line after 2 hours and 10 minutes. He's achieved his personal goal by beating his old record by a full 5 minutes.
The reward that I get from running, it's better than money or whatever. The running is keeping me alive.
Some of you are probably worried about your kids spending so much time playing video games. At times, it's tough to pry the joystick out of their hands and get them to do anything else. You may have even said, what is all this video game playing good for? What can you do with it? Well, a 10-year-old named Rawson Stovall will show you.
No doubt about it, video games are everywhere. And just when you've mastered one kind of outer space encounter, along comes another game that begs to be challenged. 10-year-old Rawson Stovall has invested a lot of time in video game playing, to say nothing of all the quarters he's also invested. The key to success in the business world, though, is to make your investments pay off, and that's just what Rawson decided to do. When he's not playing video games, Rawson is studying them. Throughout the video game stores and arcades of Abilene, Texas, he's become a familiar sight. Notepad in hand, he covers his chosen beat. He notes which games are popular. He interviews players as to their likes and dislikes. Now, having learned everything there was to know about the subject, the next question was how to put it to use.
My dad's just that put together a questionnaire with questions like, would you think a column about video games would be read? If yes, to what extent? On a scale of 1 to 10, would a column like this increase your desire to advertise in the newspaper?
My name's Rossa Stovall, and I plan to write a column about video games, and it would help me if you could fill out a questionnaire for me.
What he had to do was to prove that if a newspaper took on his column, it would pay for itself by generating new advertising for the paper. Store managers were impressed.
First time I met Rawson Stovall, he was very businesslike. To see a young man present himself in such a professional manner, he had a business proposition for me. He was very businesslike in his presentation. Of course, he made a sale. He couldn't resist him.
And after all the questionnaires were turned in to me, the response was real good. I wrote several sample articles, and after I'd written the four example sample articles, I went and got a letters of recommendation from my reading teacher, my language teacher, and I called the editor, Mr. Tarpley, at the Abilene Reporter News.
He walked in with his briefcase, with his personal card, and in a very professional, businesslike, mature manner, proceeded to tell me what he wanted to do. He normally, 10-year-old, you wouldn't take too seriously, but this guy really did a good job of providing some background and showing you knew what he was doing.
According to Time magazine, over 20 billion quarters were spent into the machines.
I see.
And the home business, over $1 billion, was spent on video game consoles that hook up to the TV.
He showed me some samples of columns he had written, and he showed me then that he had about 6 months' worth of ideas, what subject he was going to do each week. It really was a professional job, and he did a great selling job.
And the next day, when he got back in touch with me, he said, come on down to the paper. He'd talk to me about it. And the next day, when I went there, he said that I was hired.
Once a week, Rawson goes to press with his column here at the Abilene Reporter News. His work is treated just like the work of any well-read correspondent. It's typeset, printed, and distributed all over the city.
In order to do my column, I do a lot of research, and companies, software companies, are now sending me cartridges to review, prototypes, before they're ever out on the market. And
there I have a chance to write about the game before it's really ever on the market, just when people are looking forward to the game. I can tell them, you know, if it's going to be a good game or a dud. Then the next 4 months, I got picked up by 7 more newspapers, 2 in Houston, 1 in San Antonio, 1 in Waco, Killeen, and Odessa. Right now, I'm working on my first out-of-state newspaper in San Jose, California. My goal by the end of this year is to have my column syndicated in over 100 newspapers.
You've undoubtedly seen kids riding these around your neighborhood.
They're called sidewalk surfers or skateboards. And in the last decade or so, skateboarders have built their sport into an art form.
One of the best hails from McKeesport, Pennsylvania. Let's meet the skateboard king, Dave Province.
Dave starts by riding 4 skateboards at once. The skateboards are not attached to each other in any way. And he did it. Next, Dave will ride down his special ramp atop 7 skateboards. Now, Dave's an expert. Remember, don't try any of this yourself. Here he goes. A little shaky. But he made it!
And now the most difficult feat of all. 12 skateboards, one atop the other, and Dave atop them. Here he goes. He made it! Dave Province, the skateboard king.
A man named Jim Chambers has a most unusual way of getting around. It doesn't have wheels or an engine or jets or pedals or even a steering wheel. But buckle in tight, because Jim is about to take us up, up, up and away.
In Ocala, Florida, preparations are underway for a unique hot air act. It involves man's oldest flying machine, the hot air balloon.
The dream of flight was finally realized when these beautiful air floats were invented. The world's original balloonists, however, never dreamed their special aircraft could be used the way they will be today. 2 normal-sized balloons are inflated and readied for flight.
But a third, very special balloon is the key element in today's unique outing. Jim Chambers unpacks his compact balloon called the Cloud Hopper.
Chambers, an experienced balloonist, prefers the pint-sized balloons to the larger basket-carrying kind. He explains why.
This is a real responsive little balloon as opposed to a much larger one, as it has only about a quarter of the internal mass. And I can make this climb and descend and hold my altitude so much better. Plus, I'll accelerate a lot faster in a wind current than a much larger balloon.
The butane tank that heats the balloon's air is carried as a backpack. Jim has to be careful not to accidentally lift off before he is securely strapped to the tank and balloon.
And Jim never leaves the ground without his emergency pack of rope and rescue equipment. The pack strings along wherever Jim and his cloud hopper go.
Because a strong gust can throw them all off course, a long rope connects the 3 balloons so they can all stay within reach of each other.
Ropes in place, the 3 balloonists take off and get ready to position themselves in the sky.
In just a few moments, Jim will attempt his amazing balloon hopping high wire act.
We'll see more of this incredible ballooning demonstration right after this.
Landing site.
The rope that connects the balloons now serves as a towing line for Jim. Keeping a delicate balance between heating and releasing the air in his balloon, Jim carefully steers his airship into position for a piggyback landing.
The balloonist now closes in on his target. This kind of pinpoint mid-air landing can only be done with Jim's maneuverable little cloud hopper.
Touchdown, a perfect landing.
There's more to this stunt than just balloon hopping.
Jim now guides the other balloon into a difficult stack formation.
It's an incredible maneuver. He's delicately sandwiched the cloud hopper balloon between the other two. But there's still more to Jim's amazing aerial demonstration.
Jim has climbed to an even higher elevation in preparation for his second balloon walk.
Now he narrows in. There he goes, another perfect landing. Hot air balloon hopping at more than 1,000 feet in the sky. Amazing.
Over. The balloonists now head for home. While they prepare for landing, the wind suddenly picks up, throwing everyone off course. They must make an emergency touchdown.
Jim finds his balloon heading for a stand of trees, which narrowly miss grabbing him and his cloud hopper.
Despite the danger, they all land safely in an incredible demonstration of ballooning skill.
Dystonia is one of the most tragic of all afflictions. It makes life a nightmare of uncontrollable muscle spasms.
No one knows what causes certain people to lose control of their bodies. What is known, however, is that the key to reversing the condition lies deep within the human spinal cord. Recently, one woman regained control of her muscles and began a brand new life.
Carmen Scazzari's early childhood was normal, with no hints of the tragedy to come.
My first recollection of a symptom that something was wrong was in my left ankle. This happened when I was about 7 years old. The ankle would turn in, and I'd be constantly tripping over it or limping as if I had sprained the ankle. From the years to about 7 to 12, it was largely ignored as growing pains. About that time, I was then diagnosed as juvenile rheumatoid arthritis.
That diagnosis was wrong, and it wasn't until she graduated from college that Carmen learned of her problem.
We were first told that Carmen had dystonia. We didn't take it too hard, not knowing how dreadful this disease really is. And then we were told it's a very progressive disease, that Carmen would be immobile. The only thing that would function would be her mind.
It appeared that once the disease had the proper name, it took off like wildfire. So by January 80 was my first brace, a short left leg brace. And I had been told by a group of physical therapists that I had been sent to, I tentatively asked him and just said, by the way, is there any chance of a wheelchair in this? I thought it was a silly question, but I just felt I had to ask it. And they said, oh, no, 20 years down the line, don't even think of it. It was less than a year later and I was in the wheelchair.
In addition to being confined to a wheelchair, much of Carmen's body was fitted with braces to help control the constant and painful muscle spasms she suffered.
She lost more and more control of her movements. She could barely make a fist. She also lost control of her bladder and was forced to use a catheter. Meanwhile, Carmen's limbs frequently spasmed uncontrollably.
This sounds strange to say, but I had wished very much that I had been paraplegic, that it was sudden. and I knew that it would be stopped at a particular spot along the spine, and that was it. The idea of watching it go piece by piece, I needed a lot of help, which I got from the family and friends, and then professional help to say goodbye to pieces. One of the most difficult things was to go to a shopping mall and have to pass by shoe stores. And I would give in to the temptation. I would stop and look through the window and look at all the pretty shoes and think of the dresses that I'd no longer be wearing. Sometimes I would catch my reflection in the glass and I would recognize the face, wouldn't recognize the body and the wheelchair and all the hardware. And I'd move away from it as quickly as I could. When I was diagnosed with the dystonia in 79, we had two options to go with. The first was to try to treat it medically with as much medication, muscle relaxants, and things of that sort as I could tolerate, or to go with a brain surgery, a rather chancy brain surgery to try to stop this, to stop the progression of the dystonia.
But then Carmen learned of another option that offered new hope. It was a surgical procedure involving a device that electrically stimulates the spinal cord. The technique was developed by Dr. Joseph Waltz of the St. Barnabas Hospital in New York.
After Carmen came here to New York and I evaluated her, we agreed that surgery was indicated, that we could help her. This is a schematic representation of the various components of the stimulator system. The procedure begins with this needle being placed in the patient's back. The electrode wire is passed through the needle up the spinal column to the upper neck area in the cervical area where we want the electrode to be positioned. The remainder of the catheter system, electrode wire, tunnel underneath the skin to a small pocket under the skin on the left side of the patient. The receiver is implanted there, it's connected to the electrode wires. On the outside, the antenna, which is placed over the skin, over the receiver, which is connected to a transmitter which the patient wears. The transmitter sends out coded radio frequency impulses. These electrical impulses are stimulating the spinal cord, and by that we are able to overcome the abnormal electrical impulses that are coming from the brain.
Well, Carmen, she said, if this operation can alleviate the pains, excruciating pains, and if it can remove the catheter, I'm satisfied. I will remain in braces on a wheelchair for the rest of my life. I can face it. I've got a mind and I can make my mind work. That's all she was expecting. I was hoping for the same thing.
Surgery is July 29th and July 30th is when they started the stimulation. And on July 31st, Saturday, is when the results started.
That morning, I came in from the place where I was staying on the seventh floor, and I was forewarned as I came out of the elevator to walk on the seventh floor, make my left turn to where Carmen's room was, and everybody was facing me, and they were smiling and laughing, and I knew something was good was happening, and then Carmen came out of the room and walked towards me. She walked out of that hospital. Everybody was just rooting for her.
This surgical technique can have extraordinary results, but it cannot be used on all forms of dystonia, nor is it always successful.
One of the first things I did when I got home was to restring my guitar. That guitar meant so much to me, and I'm really glad to have that back. People would ask me if I was going to throw away the braces and the wheelchair and all that. And I said, no, I wasn't. But I was going to go out and finally get a new pair of shoes. My hope for the future is to work with Dr. Waltz, to work with patients with movement disorders, to help them pre-op get used to the idea that they're going to have a stimulator, and post-op to help them and the families get adjusted to their loved ones having a system like this. And I feel I could be a great help because it worked on me, for one thing, I'm just living proof. I have it right here. And they could believe me. Because it's true, it does work.
In a moment, we'll visit an extraordinary castle in the Arizona desert that fulfilled this woman's lifelong dream. A new form of laser surgery is working apparent miracles. Without it, Brad Dodson would still be going deaf. You'll see it when That's Incredible continues.
In the desert near Phoenix, Arizona, there stands a castle. It's a strange place for a castle, and the story of how it got there is even stranger. This castle was built with stones and old auto parts, but most of all, with love.
Mary Lou Gully grew up wondering why her beloved father had deserted her.
I really never knew my father. Memories of him are rather vague except for one. We used to go to the beach almost every Sunday, and we'd play in the sands, and we'd dig for clams, and he'd build these wonderful sand castles. He always read me fairy tales, and he always read me about castles, and I always wanted one. One day, when I was 4 and a half, he just disappeared. We didn't know where he was. He vanished. But he did say before he left he would build me a big castle. I really missed my father. When I was 10 years old, I had some school pictures taken, and I don't know why at the time, but I autographed one to my daddy and kept it in my room. And I used to look at it once in a while and feel very sad inside. We did look for him, and we could never find any trace, and we just presumed that he was dead.
Not until Mary Lou was an adult did the strange mystery of her father begin to unravel.
One day, 18 years after my father had disappeared, we received a telegram saying that he had just died and that he had been living in Phoenix. My first reaction was of anger and feeling very hurt that he had been living all this time and he had never let us know where he had been living or what he was doing. We were notified that he had left a handwritten will and that he had left me property in Phoenix, Arizona. Will of Voice Luther Gully, I give and bequeath to my daughter, Mary Lou Gully, a castle on the Arizona desert located in South Mountains near Phoenix. Signed, B.L. Gully.
In 1927, Voice Luther Gully had begun building a monument of love for his daughter, the storybook castle.
It reminded me of the sand castles he used to build me years ago. And it was just like all a flashback. I was with my father again. It was spooky. It was my castle, and I saw little niches and crannies and the tremendous amount of work, the ingenuity. I couldn't believe it.
Gully's work is much admired by accomplished professional architects.
When I look at this castle, I see the work of a man who designed really from his gut. He used his instincts, his intuition. He didn't design and calculate the way an engineer does. He tried some things and found they didn't work, and then he tried some other things.
Voice Luther Gully was a very solitary man, but he did accept the occasional assistance of Thomas McDonough.
He seemed to be completely tireless. He was just busy as a buzzsaw. One thing that I marveled at was how a man could undertake a project larger than an outhouse without anything in the semblance of a drawing or diagram or anything of that sort. Just make it up out of his head as he went along. He was a loner. He worked alone most of the time. The hillside on which the place was being built was his stone quarry. He just had to go out and pick it up and carry it to where he wanted it and cement it down. I sometimes helped Boyce collect water. I'd take a 5-gallon jug of drinking water out to him, and he was so remote from the water pipes in those days that that was his only way of getting water. He said very little to say about what he was doing or why or anything of that sort. Sort of a mystery man.
Boyce Gully's daughter came to learn that her father's sudden disappearance occurred shortly after he was told that he suffered from tuberculosis. It's believed he left because he couldn't bear to risk infecting his family.
He spent the rest of his life building the castle. What seemed like heartless abandonment was really a gesture of love by a slowly dying man.
If someone told me that he had, was building that for his daughter, I think that would have been a relief. It would have given me a reason for what seemed to be a most unusual undertaking.
As I walked through my castle, I suddenly realized that I had really misjudged my father. He had been building my dream castle all these 18 years, and he had done all this for me. I really felt a little guilty and very, very proud.
The mystery castle covers 8,000 square feet and contains 18 rooms. 3 million stones were used in the construction.
The building materials are the wood of old railroad cars and ties, old auto parts, and rocks from the property itself, mortared together with a secret Indian formula using goat's milk and dirt.
Handmade reliefs adorn the walls. Painstakingly set into the floors are bits of gold, granite, flagstone, quartz, and turquoise. Gully's unique castle has received acclaim from the world's top architects, and Mary Lou now opens her home to the public for tours, proudly showing off the incredible castle her father built just for her.
People ask me why I haven't moved away, why I don't go someplace else and seek my own way of living, and I said I can't, because I love this place. I feel my father around me. It's roots. It's probably the only roots I really ever had, and I'm really happy here.
If you can hear the sound of my voice, then you're luckier than hundreds of thousands of Americans who cannot hear at all. The world of silence they live in is a virtual prison, one they must live in wherever they go. We are delighted to present another story of a new medical breakthrough to cure deafness.
This is the inside of a laser. It's being carefully tested because it will be used to perform surgery.
The laser was invented only about 20 years ago, but it's come to have almost unlimited uses.
The intense light beam that a laser creates can be used to cut materials as hard as diamonds or as soft as human skin.
Here a laser makes a slice into a piece of paper. That's easy. But it could also be focused finely enough to perform delicate microsurgery on the human body.
That idea occurred to Dr. Rodney Perkins.
After a period of time, we finally developed the unit that is currently being used. Brad Dodson is a man who had noticed a progressive hearing loss over many years, but he had reached a point where this was interfering with his ability to communicate in his work and at home.
It's been about 3 years, and what I noticed first was laying in bed, not being able to hear the phone ring in the other room, my wife laying next to me hearing it, you know.
He came in for an evaluation, and we felt that he had sclerosis.
Right.
Basically, the way the ear works is sound waves go in the ear canal, strike the eardrum, vibrate it, and then these vibrations are transmitted to three little ear bones, the malleus, incus, and a stirrup-shaped bone called the stapes. Otosclerosis is a benign growth of bone. It's not a tumor in the sense of a malignancy or anything like that. That slowly fixates the stapes bone, and therefore the person does not hear as well.
This new option, which I'm really excited about, is the laser surgery, which hopefully will give me a little piston that's moving inside the bone that's fixed, and hence, couple the sound in better to the inner ear.
The operation takes about an hour and will be performed by Dr. Perkins.
I'm very excited. I really hope that, and I have good expectations that it's going to get a lot better. I'll hear a lot better in the right ear.
The laser is activated.
Dr. Perkins will perform the operation while peering through a surgical microscope that magnifies the interior of the ear about 10 times.
A speculum will help to channel the tiny fiber optical waveguide that transmits the laser light.
In the surgery for otosclerosis, an argon laser beam vaporizes the back arch of the stapes.
With a touch of a foot pedal, the laser fires multiple pulses of pinpoint light at the tiny bone in the ear. Each pulse lasts for a tenth of a second and gradually disintegrates the bone. The front arch is delicately burned away by the laser pulses.
Now Dr. Perkins carefully removes the tiny bone.
After the top of the stapes is removed, the laser is used to vaporize a rosette of small holes in the footplate portion.
The power of the laser is increased slightly so that Dr. Perkins can burn the pinpoint holes into the footplate of the inner ear. We're seeing the operation just as he sees it.
The prosthesis is placed into the hole in the stapes and attached to the neighboring ossicle.
This is very delicate work. The new artificial bone, made of platinum and Teflon, is 0.6 of a millimeter in diameter. that's small enough to easily fit through the eye of a tiny sewing needle. It's clamped into place with micro forceps.
Your operation's all over.
Good.
Been awake the whole time?
Yeah, I think so.
Does it sound better to you?
Yeah. Okay. Much louder, everything, all the sounds. I can hear people around me.
Okay, I'm going to give you some numbers, and I want you to repeat them. They'll get softer and softer, and finally you won't hear them. Okay?
Mm-hmm.
All right, 25.
25.
31.
31.
24.
24.
65.
65.
32.
I hear that.
Okay, that's very good.
Well, it just suddenly came alive at the end of the surgery. He hooked it up and feels the room sounds loud, and I can hear people's voices well, and I don't feel dizzy. I feel very clear-headed and everything. Feels fine. Can hear everybody again.
From our That's Incredible mailbag came this letter from Don Feipel, who lives in Hazel Crest, Illinois. Don saw the story we ran last year about stomach stapling. That's the dieting procedure where the stomach is actually made smaller by stapling off a section of it.
He writes, "My wife Nancy has tried everything in dieting and nothing really seemed to help her weight problem. I told her about your program and that very week she made her first appointment. She has now lost close to 95 pounds thanks to your program."
Recently we brought you the story of Dave Book, the volunteer fireman with cerebral palsy. His courage inspired many others, and we're still receiving letters like this one from Elizabeth Maris of Crowley, Louisiana, and she writes, "My cousin is 3 years old and she has cerebral palsy. She had surgery for this and is trying to walk. Thanks to your show, I now understand she can do it and she will."
If you have something incredible to share with us, here's our address. Post Office Box 25989, Los Angeles, California, zip code 90025, and please include your phone number.
If we read your letter on the air, we'll send you a That's Incredible jacket and copies of the That's Incredible book.
Now here's a preview of what's in store in the weeks ahead.
This young man is demonstrating a sport that is all his own. He calls it cycle surfing.
As a pitcher, she's thrown 30 shutouts and 17 no-hitters. Meet Samantha Ford, star of the softball diamond.
Wolfgang Mozart was a musical child prodigy. So is 5-year-old Ivan Fetch, even though he's been blind almost since birth.
A look into the world of big business is practiced by these tycoons of tomorrow. They're all around 11 years old and could be rich before they're out of school.
Before we go, we'd like to thank Dave Province for joining us tonight.
Our thanks this week go out to the folks at station KBTV Channel 9 in Denver, Colorado, for their coverage of the Rawhide Marathon.
We'll see you all next time on
That's Incredible.
Good night.
This is David Hartman. Tomorrow on Good Morning America, the son of Nazi leader Rudolf Hess talks about the Hitler diaries. Ariel Sharon talks about Lebanon. Wednesday, Daniel J. Travati and Waylon Jennings on Good Morning America.
And tomorrow, after Happy Days, watch Laverne and Shirley. Then on Saturday, be there for all the thrills and splendor of the 109th Run for the Roses with ABC Sports live exclusive coverage of the Kentucky Derby. Stay tuned now for the Monday night movie, Legs.
Incredible.